Hello and welcome, guys. My name is Steve and this is Gopher Dudes. And today we're talking about something very interesting, something we naturally and normally use without asking too many questions about. We're gonna talk about packages in Go. Before we begin any coding or presentation, let me go ahead and show you where exactly are the resources which we're gonna use in this tutorial. So if you open up your browser, you should be able to type in github.com/gophertudes/gobasics. After that, you should open up packages, and inside the packages directory you should have a bunch of examples, you should have the presentation, and you should have the readme.md, which explains a couple of useful information about packages and all that stuff. All right, guys, now that I showed you where exactly the repository is, let's go ahead and jump straight into this tutorial. So when you create a file which has the extension .go, the only required thing that you have to put inside this is the package declaration. So you have to say this file belongs to a certain package. I mean, it's pretty simple. That's the only thing you have to put inside a file as soon as you created that file.go. Speaking of package structure, packages in Go are organized across files as opposed to other languages. So basically what that means is a package is composed of multiple files, and multiple files together form a package. Speaking of package types, there are two package types in Go. As we talked earlier in other tutorials, there are main packages and non-main packages, or also known as executable packages or non-executable packages. Now, when it comes to main packages or executable packages, you have to have a main package because that's why it's called executable. You have to have an entry point. You have to have a function which begins the whole work. And you could also make use of Go run and Go build tools in order to run or build that package. Speaking of non-main or non-executable packages, basically these packages provide functionality which can be imported or used in other packages or in the main package. Alright guys, to make what I said about package types a little more clear, let me show you an example of that to prove you what I mean. So if you open up your IDE or text editor, inside packages you should have something like package types. So open up package types, here you have main and services package. So basically if you open up main.go, this is the executable package. This is the package which we finally will build or compile. And thus, this is the package which imports other packages in order to make it functional. So as you can see here, we import services.newS1. So basically we create a new service from the services package, and this functionality can be imported by any package, including the main package. So if you open up the services package, here we have s1.go. So as you can see here, we have the new s1 function, and this function is basically an exported function in order to be used or imported in other packages, packages like main, for example. Now, as opposed to executable packages, you cannot compile or execute this package. So let's say you open up a terminal and you want to execute services package. So let's open up a terminal, cd into packages and cd into package types, and let's cd into services. So basically if you try to compile the s1 file, it's not gonna work. Let me show you that. So you do an ls, it has the s1. So go run s1.go. See, it doesn't work. It says cannot run non-main package. So basically only main packages should be run, only main packages should be executed or compiled. And also keep in mind that the main package should have the main function. Now, when it comes to packages, you have to keep in mind the naming and how you structure them. And of course, when it comes to that, there are some good practices and bad practices around it. So a good practice and what's actually recommended is, if you have a directory, for example, named network, your package should also be named network. So basically your directory name should equal to your package name. A bad practice would be to name your directory net, for example, and your package name network. And that would bring a lot of inconsistency and people would not know which is which, because it brings a lot of confusion when you name your directory one way and you name your package another way. Another bad practice would be to name your directory using underscores or using camel case. That's not a good practice, and basically that's an example of poor naming. So you want to avoid that. You want to keep your packages specific and short, preferably one word. So packages like utils, misc are a bad practice and an example of poor naming, and Go team doesn't recommend that. And when you name your package name should be very specific and very descriptive, exactly to the functionality it provides. Another bad practice would be to have a lot of nested directories and nested packages, and it's also a good practice to keep it as flat as possible, to not go very nested. You have to go into nested directories or packages only if you have to, only if that makes sense. Otherwise, keep your structure as flat as possible, keep it one level, two or three maximum. So when it comes to package structuring, another good practice is, for example, if you have a package named network, it's good to have a file named network.go. That's why actually in the standard library and in many projects you'll see file named exactly as the package name, and that's really meant to be used for generic things, for common things which are going to be used across the entire package. And another bad practice would be to have inside a package multiple package declarations. So you have a flat structure, you have three files, and each file declares its own package. So basically you have like three packages inside a directory, and that's totally illegal. If you're gonna compile that, that's not gonna work. Now, when it comes to non-main packages in Go, there is a specific way you import them. So let's go ahead and have a look at the import path. So let's say you have a package PKJ and it needs to import some functionality from package net from Go Basics. So typically you do that by typing import github.com/gopher2/gobasics/net. So basically github.com is the host where Go is gonna go ahead and pull off the package from. Then follows GopherToots. So basically GopherToots is the user or organization. So in the case of GitHub host, it's the organization. Then follows Go Basics, which is really nothing else but the repository. So basically Go is gonna go ahead and knock on github.com, then knock on GopherToots, and then on Go Basics repository, and then try to pull off the net package which is inside that repository. Now, when it comes to import path, I didn't come up with this approach by myself. An import path is related to something called GOPATH. So GOPATH, in easy words, is pretty much the root or the location of pretty much every Go project. So inside GOPATH, we have the bin, the source, and the PKJ directories. So the bin directory is the place where all the binaries live, and the PKJ directory is pretty much the directory where all the third-party packages are downloaded. Now, you will interact less with these two directories, but you're more interested into the source directory. So basically the source directory is the directory where all your Go code will be stored. Now, this is very shortly about GOPATH and how it's related to import path. If you want to find more about GOPATH, make sure to check out this tutorial. Now, speaking of packages and imports, there is such a notion in Go as cross-reference. So basically cross-reference means when package A, for example, imports package B and vice versa. So basically Go doesn't allow that as opposed to other languages. So basically if you have a package A and it imports package B cannot import package A, because that's basically going to cause an import loop and that's going to be an infinite loop. So Go doesn't allow that, and it's gonna fail at compile time. So to prove you that cross-reference is not allowed in Go, let me go ahead and show you an example inside the IDE. Inside packages, you have cross-reference. So if you open up cross-reference, you have main.go. And inside main.go, as you can see here, we just import P1 and we underscore it because we don't care about the result really. We only care about this effect. So if you open up P1, inside P1, we have P1.go. Inside P1.go, we import P2. Which is another package, package P2. So if you go and open up P2 package, inside P2 package, we import P1. So as you can see, nothing is highlighted in red or something, but when you compile this program, it's not gonna work. So let's go ahead and compile this program and prove you that Go doesn't allow cross-reference. So if you open up your terminal, inside packages, you should have cross-reference, and here you have main.go, P1 and P2 packages. So let's say go run main.go. When you say go run main.go, it's not gonna work, as I said, because it says import cycle not allowed. So as I said before, cross-reference is not allowed in Go, and it's gonna compile with an error. So basically you can do that, and it's very easy to detect. You just compile a program and it's not gonna work, and you know it's a cross-reference, so you have to delete that, you have to extract those. So next, let's talk about file globals and file locals. So basically what do I mean by locals is things you have to declare inside every file of the same package. So inside every file of the same package, you have to declare two things. You have to declare the package it belongs to, and you have to declare the dependencies, the package it depends on, the package it imports. So basically, let's say if you have import font package inside file A, you cannot use font package inside file B. You have to explicitly import the font package inside file B as well. And there's also such a thing as globals. So what do I mean by globals? Well, globals are declarations which you have to declare once inside at least one file, and it's gonna be available inside every file of the same package. To give you an example of that, globals are things like constants, variables, and functions. So if you declare a constant, a variable, or a function inside at least one file of the same package, it's gonna be available in every other file of the same package. So to make locals and global declarations a little more clear, let's open up our IDE and show you an example of that. So again, inside your IDE or text editor, wherever you got, you have packages, and inside packages, you have something like local versus globals. So let's open up main.go. So inside main.go, as you can see, we have these two things which I called locals. We have the package main and we have the import font. So basically, if you open up square.go, you cannot say like this file belongs to the main package or this file just uses font package out of nowhere. You have to explicitly say this file belongs to the main package and this one uses the font dependency. So basically you have to be explicit about these two. That's why I call them locals. Now when it comes to globals, let's talk about globals a little bit. So if you open up main, we use this function square delta, but we didn't declare this function here. We declared it in square.go. So basically functions are also globals, right? So inside this function square delta, we have a print, and then we have a return. And notice here inside this return, we have x multiplied by x multiplied by delta. And we didn't declare delta in this file because it's a global. We declared it inside main. So if you open up main, we declared delta here. So basically, we can use this delta because it's a global. It's a global across the entire package, and it's available inside every file of the same package. So let me go ahead and run this program to prove you that this actually works. So if you open up your terminal, you should be able to cd into packages, and then we have locals versus globals. And then here you can say go run main.go, but it's not gonna work if you just say go run main.go, because as you can see here, as you remember, square.go is also part of the main package. And if you say go run main.go, it's not gonna work because you need two files. You have a dependency on that function. So keep that in mind. So when you say go run, you need to say everything.go or star.go. So now it's gonna work. It's gonna work because we compiled every file which is inside the package main. So that's the result of it. So we talked earlier about non-main packages and packages which provide functionality which can be imported in other packages. However, there is a small exception to this. So when it comes to test files, files which end up with underscore test.go, basically there is a small exception to this. So anything you declare inside a test file, even though it's exported, you cannot import inside another test file, even though it's exported. So that's a small exception to keep in mind, so don't forget about that, because otherwise you'll have some nightmare with this. So to make a little more clear what I said about test packages, let's open up our IDE and have a look at an example. So if you open up your IDE or text editor, inside packages you have test packages. So if you open up test packages, you have pkj1 and pkj2, and you have pkj1.go, pkj1_test.go, pkj2.go, and pkj2_test.go. So if you open up pkj1, you have an exported symbol, and this one imports pkj2.exported. So if you open up pkj2, inside pkj2, it's totally legal. You export a symbol and you import it here. So basically this is gonna work if you compile, if you run this program. However, if you open up pkj2_test.go, you can also see an export declaration here. However, if you try to import this inside this file, if you try to import pkj2.exported2, which is a exported constant inside that test file, it's not gonna work. So as I said before, when you try to import exported symbols from test files, even though they are exported, it's not gonna work because they are test files and Go completely ignores them. Speaking of package visibility and scope, as you may already know, exported means anything that starts with uppercase, anything like constants, types, functions, anything that starts with uppercase, that means it's exported. Anything else, it's unexported. So basically, exported means visible inside every file of the same package and visible outside of that package. Unexported or private, if you're coming from another language, means it's visible inside every file of the same package, but not visible or not accessible outside of that package. So we talked about GOPATH, and I said that the source directory is the directory which you're most likely gonna be interested into. Now let me go ahead and show you a diagram of GOGET, how GOGET works, and how is that related to the source directory from GOPATH. So let's say inside your project somewhere you have an import path like this: github.com/stevehook/repo/some package. In order for Go to deliver you that package, it's gonna have to do the following steps. So it's gonna go ahead and knock on github.com/host, and then it's gonna ask for stevehook user, and then it's gonna ask for repo repository, and it's gonna look for that package which you're trying to import. And after that, it's gonna try to download the package and place it inside gopath/source or gopath/pkg, depending on the package manager which you're using. If you're using no package managers, it's just gonna try to put it inside gopath/source. So I explained GOGET before, but I didn't get very much into specifics. So that's why let's go ahead and open up our IDE and show you an example. Inside packages, you have GOGET. So if you open up GOGET, nothing fancy here. So let's open up main.go. So inside main.go, we have a simple HTTP server. So basically we import a third party package by having this import path. And before we're gonna run this program, let's go ahead and run GOGET in order to import everything that we need before we run this program. So let's open up our terminal and let's cd into packages, and then we have GOGET, and here we say GOGET dot slash dot dot dot. And what this is gonna do is basically gonna try to fetch every package that we have as a dependency from our current directory. So it's gonna take our current directory and it's gonna try to look into import paths and try to download every package that we have in the import paths, taking the current directory as the source code. Also notice here we're using Go modules, so don't worry about Go modules because we're gonna cover them in the next tutorials. But just so you know, inside go.mod we have dependencies. So basically here is how you declare your modules, and here we use the go 1.12, and here we require this package. So Basically, here we say require, and we provide the import path, and we provide the version. So that's pretty much GoMod, but don't worry too much about GoMod because we're gonna cover that in a later tutorial, which is coming up next. So without further ado, let's go ahead and run this program to show you how this actually works. So let's go ahead and say go run main.go, and nothing happens. Well, it actually happens. We're running an HTTP server right now. So let's go ahead and open up another terminal window and let's test this HTTP server. So I'm gonna open up another terminal window and I'm gonna say curl localhost 8080. Because this is the address which we gave here, as you can see, and boom. So as you can see, welcome prints. It prints this message which says here. Let's also try localhost 8080 slash people slash Steve, for example. As you can see, this thing works. So basically, this is a simple HTTP server in Go using a third-party package just to demonstrate how Go Git works. So if you like this, make sure you play with this. Next, let's talk about some special directories which you have to be aware of when developing Go projects. So if you have a vendor directory inside your project, it's gonna look very similar to the source directory inside GoPath. It's gonna have the same github.com or gitlab.com, the user and the repo and all that stuff. So basically, when you import, your import path is still gonna look the same, but it's gonna import it from the vendor directory as opposed to from GoPath. Speaking of internal is a directory which is more suitable for developing libraries. So basically, if you have an internal directory inside your project, anything that's exported from those packages inside the internal directory is going to be available inside your library. However, if you try to import those exported symbols outside the library, for example, if you have your program, your application, and you're trying to import that library, you're not going to have access to those exported symbols because they are placed inside internal directory. So anything placed inside internal, it's only internal. It's only available inside that library, that framework. It's not going to be available inside your application. And then there are the rest of the packages, something like pkj, cmd, .dir, underscore dir, and test data. Let's talk about these quickly. So pkj is more like a convention. You'd place anything that's exported, anything that's public API, and that's again more suitable for developing libraries. So basically inside cmd, you could have multiple main files which generate your application in different ways. So cmd in the end is for multiple binaries, for multiple use cases of the same application. So if you have an application, let's say is dependent on the environment, you could generate multiple binaries of the same application depending on the context, depending on the environment. And then you have .dir or underscore dir or test data. So basically these directories are ignored by the Go tool. I actually tried this on my own. I'm not sure how these are ignored because I try running Go install, I try running Go build, and it generated the binaries, it generated the archives. I'm not sure how these are ignored by the Go tool, but at least that's what it says. If you don't trust me, let's go ahead and open the terminal and let me show you. So if you open up your terminal, you should be able to type go help packages. So basically at the end here it says directory and file names which begin with dot or underscore are ignored by the Go tool, as are directory name test data. I'm not sure how these are ignored by the Go tool, but at least that's what it says. All right guys, that's pretty much it on this tutorial. If you like this video, make sure to put a thumbs up. If you didn't like this video, make sure to smash it and subscribe if you aren't already. Also make sure to check the description of this video because everything we used in this tutorial is there, starting from the presentation, the code, links to social media, and everything is there. So make sure to check the description of this video. And if you have any comments or feedback, make sure to leave it in the comments below, and also make sure to check out the feedback link and make sure to leave your feedback there if you want to. If you want to stay anonymous, or if you want to, I don't know, suggest me a next tutorial I should make or anything like that. Also, don't forget to make sure to check out the next tutorial which is coming because it's going to be related to this one. The next tutorial we're talking about package management, so make sure to check out the next tutorial. So stay tuned and I'll see you in the next video.